fostering self-reliance in dairy industry, organized by Indian Dairy Engineers Association and National Dairy Research Institute, Karnal. We have with us Dr. Dheer Singh, officiating director, ICAR NDRI, Karnal. Dr. Sumer Agarwal, president, IDEA. Dr. Engineer Ramesh Chug, sir, vice president, IDEA. Dr. I.K. Sahani, sir, former head, Dairy Engineering Division, ICAR India, Karnal, and Vice President, IDEA. Dr. P. Burnwal, Head Dairy Engineering Division, and Dr. Chitnayak, sir, co-convener for this webinar. And I also welcome all the participants who have joined us with this for this webinar. May I now request Dr. P. Burnwal, sir, Head Dairy Engineering Department, ICAR India, Karnal, to please formally give the welcome address. So,
okay. Thanks, Priyanka. Honorable Chief Guest today, Dr. Dheer Singh, Officiating Director, ICAR National Dairy Research Institute, Karnal, and our esteemed Director, Dr. M.S. Chauhanji, who is not here today due to some unavoidable reasons and on tour. So we requested Dr. Dheer Singh, sir, yesterday, and he kindly requested. We are very thankful to him to be chief guest at this function. Our director is not here. And I welcome you all in this webinar. I heartily welcome to ID officials, Engineer S.C. Agarwal, Dr. I.K. Sahani, Dr. Chitnayak, our distinguished speakers, Mahesh Kumarji and others. Dear participants, delegates, and all other who are attending this webinar and who are sincerely committed to make this webinar successful. This webinar is jointly organized by IDEA, Indian Dairy Engineers Association, and Dairy Engineering Division, ICAR, and DRI Karnal, to brief about our division, that is Dairy Engineering Division. It is established since inception of our National Dairy Research Institute. If we see the diploma course in dairy engineering, it is started 59 years way back in 1962, that is November 1962, by Government of India in collaboration with UNICEF and FAO at our dairy engineering division. And this diploma course in dairy engineering was continued up to 1984-85. And in 1972, dairy engineering was the one of the very important disciplines which were identified for postgraduate research and training. And in 1977-78, dairy engineering was also one of the main important disciplines where students were admitted for the PhD degree programs. We are here to in this division. We are doing so many activities related to teaching, research, and some consultancy projects also. So I welcome you all. And today's webinar topic is engineering self-reliance in dairy industry, and it is in line with our Prime Minister who addressed on May 12, 2020, who has coined this term self-reliant India or Atmanirbhar Bharat, and our theme is also in the same direction, engineering self-reliance in dairy industry. So I welcome you all for this, and thanks to everyone. Welcome you all. Thank you very much. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Thank you so much, sir. May I now request Engineer S.C. Agarwal, sir, President, IDEA, and former Additional Managing Director, Milkfed Punjab, for the introductory remarks of the webinar. Sir, please.
Good morning, Dr. Dheer. This is a pleasure to be first of all. Happy birthday to my wonderful family, Dr. Sahani, 68th birthday. I request
आपकी आवाज जो है ना, इट्स इको हो रही है. आई थिंक यू आर सिटिंग इन द सेम
रूम. सिटिंग
आप एक थोड़ा वो बंद कर दीजिए, क्योंकि इको हो रही है. आपकी आवाज आती नहीं सर.
सबको
दूसरा रूम दे दीजिए, नहीं तो है सर. हाँ चलिए डॉक्टर साहब.
Sir, Indian Dairy Engineering Association concept was this association was created in 2002. The sole purpose that all the was there was One particular aspect of the industry, that is engineering side, it was created in 2002, and thereafter we had a wonderful number of seminars, conferences, and two more conferences in NDRI Karnal, sir. The second conference in around 2004, and then our ninth conference in 2014. We had very good conferences in NDRI Karnal, and first conference was highly successful in the sense there was a lot of interaction between the dairy industry, dairy engineering industry, as well as the scientists of NDRI Karnal, and a lot of MOUs were signed.
Also,
And probably we are also in the engineering area, in technology are also marching ahead in that line. And it's a very opportune time to deliberate on the subject, so that in coming time, whether it's a dairy equipment manufacturing, whether it's a dairy process or technology, India becomes self-reliant. So I wish this webinar a great success, and I hope that participants should be benefited from the experience versus my colleague Sandeep Sharma is a very learned officer, expert engineer. They will give the wonderful view. Thank you very much. I wish you all a great success to the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the introductory remarks for the webinar, and as a common information to all the participants who have joined about IDEA and the activities the IDEA has been conducting for the benefit of all the engineers all around India. Now may I request Dr. I.K. Sahni, sir, Vice President IDEA, former Emeritus Scientist and former Head, Dairy Engineering Division, ICR, NDRI Karnal, for exposition of the national webinar. Sir, please.
Good morning and welcome to today's national webinar on engineering self-reliance in dairy industry. This is our first virtual session in these extraordinary times of COVID disturbances, and Indian Dairy Engineer Association is very pleased to join NDRI Karnal as a co-organizer of this event. Many thanks to all of you to joining us, especially the Honorable Director NDRI Karnal, who has spared his time and joining this webinar. Before we get started, I would take a few minutes to apprise you about the webinar aims and objectives. We all know that milk processing is a multi-technology activity. Technology innovations are constantly transforming the dairy industry across all aspects of plant operation. To engineer self-reliance in dairy industry, we need active contribution from all the stakeholders from different disciplines. For self-reliance and sustainability, the resource utilization efficiency is the main focus, and in this aspect, dairy engineering is always in the forefront. In today's webinar, four eminent scientists are joining us across the country. Dr. Mahesh Kumar will be joining us from Hebbal, Bengaluru. Dr. P. Sudhir Babu is joining us from Munuthi, Kerala. Dr. J.B. Upadhyay is joining us from Anand, Gujarat. And Dr. Sanjeev Sharma is joining us from Chandigarh, Punjab. They all will be sharing their valuable experiences and vision in the field of their expertise on the trends, contributions, energy efficiency, and resource utilization, all towards the Atmanirbhar dairy industry and dairy plants. IDEA plans to continue this webinar deliberation on this topic. This is a very important and relevant topic in today's time. So IDEA wants to continue this by transforming this webinar into webinar series. In coming days, more such webinars will be planned, where more experts will be joining us and discussing another set of contemporary topics from their field of expertise and prominent persons from education and industry will be joining us. We are planning to have a rotation system. Next time webinar will be held from some other place, some other coordinators and another set of speakers on a new topic related to this self-reliance in dairy, engineering self-reliance in dairy industry. Today's webinar is our first page of this proposed webinar series, and we are fortunate to have our director with us to flag off our proposed venture. Thank you, Dr. Deer Singh Ji, for joining us for flagging off our webinar series. We shall remain indebted to you. I extend my all greetings to all participants, learned speakers who have joined this webinar. Thank you
so much, sir, for giving exposition to the national webinar. I take honor in now inviting Dr. Dheer Singh, sir, officiating director, ICR India Rai Karnal, to please give the presidential remarks as well as give motivation to all of us and also flagging to for this webinar to be a success. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Priyanka. So, very good morning to all of you, and it's my pleasure to be to give me this to address actually this webinar. And of course that Dr. Barnwala has already informed that I am just on the behalf of our honorable director MS Chauhan, and he has actually also conveyed the message. And first of all, I would like to convey his message that to be for your all success, and also asked me to be just address on behalf of our NDRI. So thank you very much for giving for this opportunity. So I outset, I would like to thank actually the head DT for invitation, and of course the president, Dr. S.C. Agarwalji, and our vice president, Dr. Sani. This is our very senior colleagues from the NDRI. So I think that's this particular society is very good because in terms of the industry academia meet. So once again, I welcome all the distinguished speaker. I'm not very familiar with all the speaker because basically I'm a basic biochemist. So, but anyway, it is our honor on behalf of our institute. I welcome you, and of course that Dr. Sani has informed that this is a very distinguished speaker. So I'm sure that all the distinguished speaker is going to be shared. Well, let me sum up the point actually on my behalf of actually our honorable director and NDRI. I would like to share some of my important views. As far as if you look this particular society, I have already informed, I told that this is a really very good because academy industry this. Because one is a president from industry and one is vice president, and sometimes is vice versa. So industry academia meet itself is very important in India. Because generally in India, because not in United States or in developed countries, because these are the two important, European Union and the United States. If you look actually, the most of the academia industry meet is always very successful. But unfortunately, you can say in India, we are very parallel. We are going just like a river. We generally never meet actually as far as this. I think there is an initiative by engineering. I like very good as far as this abbreviation of this. Today's this idea. Idea is very popular because of industries, right? So one most important thing is that as far as dairy industry is concerned, of course, the topic is very important because of self-reliance, and it is a slogan of our Prime Minister of India, Sri Modi ji, and we are looking for self-reliance. But if you look really, what is the self-reliance? Self-reliance is not to buy from abroad and assemble it here. And as far as dairy industry is concerned, is a very successful story of India, because as NDRI, what we call National Dairy Research Institute. Sometime if you go to the United States, because I'm also associated in my last phase of 5 years, I'm also working in some of the important aspect of milk processing. And you can't believe this, because if United States go to the United States, their academia is working in the area which is not even implemented into dairy industry. So what do I wanted to tell that we should be foresee for the future, and for the foresee of future, academia can be very important role actually for to industry. So we have to be go into that area where we have to be make actually self-reliant. As far as NDRI is concerned, and this is a very important aspect to discuss, and I will also urge actually the president of IDEA and Vice President Dr. Sami here to idea. Please expand this actually society, because what I could see it right now, dairy industry means only dairy as far as dairy processing is concerned. Of course, processing is very important, because if you look our livestock production is concerned in India, of course the livestock production is going very fast. Approximately right now in 2020, the 11 lakh crore actually asset of the livestock product. Out of 11 lakh crore of India, 7 lakh crore coming from the dairy, and in dairy as per milk and milk product. And the processing is very less as compared to the actually overall, because you might be knowing that I need not tell all of you are very expert as far as this processing production is very, very less. But if you take in India, in our NDRI also, total revenue generation, this is a very alarming, I would like to share all of you. As far as the total milk production, because we have one revolving fund, I think Dr. Sahni must be aware of that. That revolving fund, if we all enroll, the production is coming on 1.1 or 2 crores of revenue generation on the sale, because our revolving fund actually purchase the milk from NDRI and give revenue, which is approximately about 2 to 3 crore, but it's almost double as far as processing is concerned. So revolving fund generation, what is coming, because there is a large, actually this figure when I came to know. So the processing has very important, but processing and production has to go, because NDRI is a dairy institute, but there is a 50% or more than means only two department is working in dairy production and processing, dairy technology and dairy processing. Most of department is associated with the production side. I have also means this particular society as engineer, there is our production side is very lacking. I think there is no support of engineering department to the production side, because now the newer area is coming. I can share some of the good example. I will suggest that if this particular society can expand actually to the word production side also, because production is also important. If there is no production, how the processing you will do? Of course, right now the processing we do not have, actually the milk is the problem, but milk we have to be, if you look for the doubling farmer is concerned, then production and processing has to go together. And I have listened from several time our experimental dairy that we are not getting a milk production very high. Of course, our institute is not for milk producing, it is a research institute. But the production side also, there is a lot of importance is the processing engineers can be help us in production side. Like stress detection, that is now the artificial intelligence, there are several actually area that is all engineers are aware of that. But we are not implementing. I think I can share one of the thing. Now the engineering is not only to assemble this, only the making this instrument, or you can say the making the Khoya machine, but also the advance actually the feature of why not we can develop, our engineer can develop a model that from our production side, the milk production state actually we put into the milk into there and come to the actually the our experimental, experimental dairy experimental. And all the parameter to reach to the experimental dairy, whether is clean or there, how much pesticide is there, how much actually is the adulterant is there, how much contamination is there. Once it is going to be in reach to the experimental dairy, every figure should be on the computer. And there is a system can be available. For example, one success story into the mechanization and dairy feeding is the D level. They have actually the developed instrument, how much a feed actually animal is taking, what is the quality of feed is there, and what the end actually, what is they are going to be give every data. So this particular engineers can do, the basic scientists cannot do actually, because we are not aware. That's why I always request actually Barnwal also, Dr. Barnwal, the head of departments of the, please expand it and enter into and make the, our scientists to be sufficient knowledge actually the latest area of engineering, because science has no boundary. It is not that you have trained into dairy technology only, you should be trained into the throughout the whole life of the survey. You have to be expand yourself depending upon need. And if there is a need of today is that you have to be mechanized the plant, you have to mechanize the plant. Like a sensory evaluation is one thing. Sensory evaluation in our India is still going on actually as far as based on our system of the 10 people, 100 people and 200 people in the questionnaire. Why not the engineering people can develop based on machine learning and AI system?
If you give feedback for 10 and 50 100 data, immediately based on that AI, you can sense what the sensory evolution of the based on manipulation. So that AI can now the sense, because there is a several methodology has been developed today. If you put the database only and the based on, like in medical science, now a dietitian, a doctor, you just tell 5, 10, 3 things that what is your age, what is your eating, what is your problem, and what they put into the computer science, immediately they will tell what they actually feed you, food you need, what type of food you need, and doctor is going to prescribe based on the AI, artificial intelligence programming. There are several publications is coming into the IIIA journal. That's a very highest ranked triple journal, because I'm aware of some of the actually the area where we want to be published into IIIA. I'm a basic bioscientist, but I want to be visualized based on AI. I want to be published. Why not our engineers? So this is the some of the actually the flags I want. I would once again request our the president of the society and vice president of society and all the distinguished member of the society, please widen this area and try to be actually the train and invite. So like Dr. Saini was telling, I'm going to be expertise. Why not invite the actually the novel people from outside abroad? Just you send a request. I'm telling why I can share my, because I have organized several international conferences where I invited more than 15 and 16 countries people. If you just send a one letter, everyone is looking for their own recognition. If you invite some of the dairy industries expert into, because I'm associated with the United States One Milk Genomics Consortia, and that consortia is actually several engineers are involved. They are actually teaching us how the actually the engineers can help into the milk processing production. So if you invite them and you just widen and you can make the actually, for example, I share, I am working in one area where, let me share it here, and I'm telling that engineers have been already developed. I'm 100% sure none of our engineers or our dairy industries people have been aware of that. I can assure you. So I have published paper in couple of 5 years where the milk, listen please, the milk has nucleic acid present into the milk. That nucleic acid is going into our human body, just like a fat, carbohydrate, proteins, mineral, vitamins. We are only know this. But the gene of buffalo and cows goes to human body, and there is a protection of system. There is a system of label, and they go into the, our human body. So human buffalo gene regulate our human gene. So the United States people, because there is a certain, that gene has a very detrimental effect of human body, and there is a some beneficial effect. So they have a developed a technology that they can remove that particular nanoparticle from a milk, and they patented it. And they have developed a complete what is called a dairy system, just what is the pipes and all. And then we pass through the milk, they remove that actually nanoparticle, so that all the gene which is going from the different animal, because they are not, biology is not yet, biology is still not knowing how it is going to affect it. That's why, because this is the biology actually milk making. Otherwise, if you go 10,000 years back, you are not even know we cannot take the milk because of mutation into the lactase gene. Once the mutation in lactase gene happened, then only we started the milk into European. There is a paper published into the Nature in India, Nature India, that is a diaspora of dairy industry. The first European that evidence of the paneer making in the clay pot is from United States. They have paleobotanists has done, and they have given this, and there is a very good paper. I will suggest all of engineers, all of the industry people should read that paper 10,000 years before actually the lactation. Similarly, if there is buffalo and the cow is going inside, and they are actually going to be dictators, so they are removing that, and they have already patented the technology, and they make the actually the industry by which they can remove it. But that is still not come into the market because biology is not ready. What I wanted to say here, sir, this biology and industry should go together. Academia and industry should go together. We should also aware of that what future we need it. Otherwise, what happened? What the machinery, what the chilling is there, what the actually this ultrafiltration is there, all the membrane is coming from there, all the, because we are not aware of that. So we have to be very strong, and that's why I appreciated, I just telling in the beginning also, academia industry meet is really very interesting, and that your society, where the president is from academy, I'm very happy, because sometimes academy has their own thinking that I am the best, industry thinking I am the best, but not, no one is best, everyone is the best. My policy is everyone is the best. We have to be join hand and we have to go together. This is one what we wanted. Another, the quality. Now the quality is very important. Our industry, our engineer people not involved into any quality assessment and developing this. Prime Minister, in our EFC this time, the Prime Minister and PMO has already sent us as a dairy industry academy institute, dairy production technology is our scheme where the six institutions are involved. They have told this, you have to be keep sufficient amount into the adulterant and this toxicant analysis, because that is a need of our. If you look actually, our dairy industry people, our the academia is not associated with this as far as quality assurance is concerned. They are, should also move to microbiology, dairy chemistry people are looking for us. They are very, we are very ahead in dairy chemistry and engineering over the nation as far quality assurance. Our kit is using into FSSI for the pesticide pan-India analysis. So I think now this is the, because biology, chemical and chemical analysis take time. But industry, the engineering people can develop a several smart gadget for the quality assessment also. I urge again this, that our head of department, that please train our scientists into this and take the industry feedback from industry, what type of instrument, how much minimum time they required, and that's this is important. So with this actually the remark once again, and thanks all of you, and thanks for giving me opportunity to share. Of course I'm sharing this, getting this opportunity on behalf of our honorable director Dr. M.S. Chauhan. But I'm sure that if he is there, they must be also, because Dr. Chauhan has also urging and two IRC, we are focusing our in dairy industry engineering group to be cope up with this all production and processing with very advanced thing. So with this remarks, so once again, thank you very much to this idea and the president and vice president, all the distinguished speaker. I hope our department, our the dairy engineering department under the leadership of our the previous head, Dr. Sahni, will definitely join with the, all the industry people, will come out with the specific recommendation. I will request Dr. Barnwal, please send actually the recommendation and proceeding what the come. I would request the president from industry side and vice president from academy side, please give me only few recommendation, 2, 3, 4, right? And I assure you that I will try to implement in our institute curricula for this to resolve. But please don't give. Because generally what happened in the most of, I am associated with the several society at the executive level also. Most of the actually the society recommendation end with this actually after the completion of virtual meetings or the physical meeting earlier. But please give me 2, 3. I can suggest one academia and one industry highly needed recommendation which you think as academia should implemented into this. So if you can give me this, I will assure you that I am going to be implemented in our curricula as far as reverse research. I am a joint director researcher, and if you have a really any need based research mandate, I assure you that not I am just telling, but I will immediately start some project into the our institute from dairy industry. So with this actually, thank you once again, thank you very much.
Hello,
Priyanka. Priyanka, where are you? Let us move forward to this side.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Unmute karo.
Thank you so much, sir. We are extremely sorry for this technical difficulty that came in between. But I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Dheer Singh, sir, for giving motivating words as well as giving a direction and guidelines to the association as well as the dairy engineering department on the latest topics or the latest areas to work on with, so that along with processing the production side, so both can go hands in hand, so that India can really mark its position in the global scenario of dairy processing as well. So thank you so much, sir, and we are looking forward, as we have people from the industry as well as academia, highest people here. So we look forward to this working in collaboration with the industry and recognizing the problems through the help of such webinars, so that further improvement can be done in wherever we are lacking as of now. Thank you so much, sir, for your words.
Thank you very much.
Now, thank you, sir. With the permission of our today's chief guest, Dr. Dheer Singh, sir, and President IDA, I may now request the speakers, and we are moving towards the speakers now. Sir, shall we start with the speakers now?
Yeah, please go ahead. And thank you. I will keep listening it. May not be interacting frequently because I have another assignment. But I assure I will be, with this, I will listen it because I am really interested to be here from you, particularly industry.
Thank you so much, sir.
And listening into IIRC and other.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. President.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
There was thank you, sir. For a small time, so
thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. We are moving towards the lectures, invited lectures now, and with all the permission of the presidents of IDEA and our respected chief guests, sir. So a few guidelines to all the participants and all the speakers and the participants before we move towards the invited lectures. I request all of you to kindly mute your phone while the speakers are delivering their deliberated talks. If we have any urgent call or message, we can please mute our speaker for our coordinate.
What happened, Priyanka?
पावर कट हो
गई
है इन इंडिया में पावर तो होती है वैसे तो कोई प्रॉब्लम इंडिया में बट यू शुड बी हैव मेक ऑल रेडी थिंग्स राइट अल्टरनेट यू हैव शुड मेक इट
So a little bit of guidelines to all the speakers and the participants before we watch this lecture. So I request all the other participants other than the speakers to kindly mute your platform so that there are no problems while the speakers are delivering their deliverables. And also the talks are being recorded. We will make sure that the recorded lecture will be on the YouTube platform for any other that later knowledge may use of, and also there have some things in the regarding the participant certificate. Clear the all participants' name and address so the certificate can be provided later on. And lastly, I request our respected to kindly be careful of the timeline as we have distinguished guests with us who have other important assignments as well. So with this remarks, we are moving. Word of Ish Kumar Ji, Dairy Engineering, Dairy Science College, KVA, Bangalore, Karnataka. Delivering golden opportunities in dairy industry to become self-reliant. Sir, I may request Ish Kumar Ji to please start the talk. Thank you so much, sir. So you can please share your slides now.
गुड मॉर्निंग टू टुडेज चीफ गेस्ट डॉक्टर दीप सिंह जी इंचार्ज डायरेक्टर एनडीआरए करनाल और प्रेसिडेंट डॉक्टर सुमेर अग्रवाल जी माय मेंटर एंड वाइस प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ आईडीए डॉक्टर सानी सर Vice President IDA, Dr. Ramesh Shiv sir, today's seminar, today's webinar convener, Dr. B. Paranwal sir, and Dr. Chitranaik sir, General Secretary IDA, and today's co-convener, and my distinguished speakers, Dr. Sudhir Babuji, and Dr. Upadhyay sir, and Sanjeev Sharma ji, Dr. Baraniya sir is there, good morning sir, and Dr. Parekh sir is there, good morning. And I can see Dr. Vasthi sir also. Good morning to everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to share my experiences so that, you know, how we can become Atmanirbhar with respect to dairy industry. So I am Mahesh Kumar. I am heading Dairy Engineering Department, Dairy Science College. Ours is a 41 years old college. So with this, I'll start today's talk on engineering self-reliance And my topic is golden opportunities available to make India Atmanirbhar. So this Atmanirbhar Bharat, it's a brainchild of our Prime Minister Modi. So he wanted to make self-reliant so that we will not depend on others, so that we will not import. We will start export to all the countries like China. That was the concept of Atmanirbhar Bharat. So remembering the thought process of our Prime Minister Modi, Modi sir. So I have made the places where we can encash the opportunities to make India self-reliant. So this Make India concept is not a program. It's a vision and mission, and it's happening. So and in he declared Stand Up India, Make in India with that concept. So Prime Minister Modi is making India become self-reliant to different sectors by encouraging youngsters. That's the concept of this Make India concept. So now I will enter into the slide. What are the golden opportunities available in dairy industry to become Atmanirbhar, that is self-reliant? So I have divided my topic into two portions. Opportunities at farm level. Farm level, I mean village level. So that our youngsters who are staying in village level, so they will also encash the opportunities and will become Atmanirbhar. So now startups in cow dung and urine business could get about 60% government funding. This is the announcement made by under Rashtriya Karmadhi Ayog Fund for startups for monetizing cow dung and urine. That means to produce the product from cow dung and urine and also to establish cow hospitals. So Mr. Vallabh Kataria, the chairperson of Rashtriya Karmadhi Ayog, so this project is available in the Government of India website, so that you can make product or you can start a company, so which will produce or value add the cow dung and urine. So there is a funding available. So it's one of the opportunity available at village level. Instead of converting dung into manure, so you can make it as a value added product. So this repetition. So now you can see this slide. So is Mr. Nagaraj from Bangalore. So he last year he did 100 crore rupees turnover by just converting dung into cake. So his company name is Amrut Organics. Amrut Organics is the company in Bangalore. So last year he made 100 crore rupees turnover just by selling cow dung. So that is the opportunity available at village also. And this is the equipment which we can use to dewater the and to make cake. And after dewatering, so we get lumps that can be passed through extruder. You can make briquettes or pellets that can be put into agriculture field as a fertilizer. So it's transportable. It has got a keeping, it has got a keeping quality, no smell. This one opportunity available. It can be encashed by our rural youths. And this innovative thought process, dung parts for plant growth. So dung, instead of making cake or putting it as a fertilizer, you can make as a parts so that you can grow plants, and this dung will act as a nutrients, and it undergoes degradation, and there is no use of using plastics. And this technology we are planning to develop in our department. It's a start process. I think all of you can start working. This concept is not yet realized. So this is one opportunity available for our youngsters to make parts and validation to the urine. So we call it as ARK. ARK is the ARK is ARK. So that is distilled urine, especially from our local animals. And you can see our CM of UP is on other side. They say there is value for cow urine, and it is to be established, all those things, ethical committee and all, it has to be proven. But so now our Kamadini mission has declared, so value addition to cow dung and value addition to urine is possible. So the validation to cow dung, I explained you. The validation to urine is cow urine, especially from our native breeds, is converting into ARK. What is that ARK? ARK is the ARK is made from Gomutra of our native breeds like Sahiwal, like Gir, like our Malnad Gitta, like our Amrut Mahal. The urine from Gomutra is distilled, and it is converted into Gomutra ARK and it is sold at under 280 rupees per liter. So it will act as a medicine. It can be used as a medicine. What is the process? This is the process. Simple distillation process. It's arc distillation process. So distillation is carried out under vacuum so that nutrients are not damaged. This is, you know, it's like distillation of our liquors. So same equipment. So arc is loaded at the bottom and it is distilled under vacuum, and clarified arc is collected that will be used as a medicine. This is the one of the golden opportunity available at village level, and village youths are who are owning dairy farms, instead of, you know, letting the urine to go into the fertilizer field, they can collect and process and see the value. Every liter, at least they'll get under rupees per liter. That's one of the opportunity available from farm level. And so Panchamrita, I think all of us know, Panchamrita can be used both for human consumption and plant food. So both are available, and that's one opportunity available from for the rural use. Panchagavya and Jeevamrita powder we developed in our university by vacuum drying process, and it keeps well for long time. And we've observed that there was no degradation of nutrients and microbes also, because drying took place at around 45 degrees. So this opportunity available for rural use to for value addition of cow dung and urine. And success, you know, I'll share some of the success startups. Many startups have come up in India, in Bangalore, so many startups. And, you know, Bangalore is out for startups. So every second, third person has got a startup. So I'll share the some of the startups who have taken up the dairy farming, and dairy farming is their profession, and they have made a lot of money and they have become self-reliant. See, this very important requirement for the success of any farm is hygienic milk collection that we call milk collection, so that bacteria numbers are reduced, which we call it as a clean milk production. If milk is produced under controlled condition without contamination, so there is a value. And in Bangalore market or in urbans, milk is sold at under 110 rupees. That's the price for fresh milk. Now demand for fresh milk is growing. So now it's the time to make consortium. One farmer cannot do anything. It has to be consortium, and if they join together, they can produce fresh milk, and there is a market for fresh milk. And value addition, they can do value addition at their farm itself. So they can make value addition, and they can sell. Small plants are available these days. They can do really big business. And this ghee, I think all of us know, this ghee is made from A2 milk. I know in Bangalore market, this ghee is available for 2,000 to 4,000. And there are many buyers, but there is no ghee. This ghee is made from our local cows, and that's the price tag they have put, and it is sold at 2,000 to 4,000 liters, and that means our rural youths, they can take up this project. It doesn't cost much. I'll share some of the slides, what will be the equipment, how big, what will be the investment, and this is the equipment. So this is one for melting the ghee. It will cost about 70,000 rupees. One clarifier will cost you 65,000 rupees. That's all the project. So anybody can make about 100 kg of ghee every day. So this is very easy. We don't require a very high technology. You can make comfortably ghee from our local cow's milk. And this one opportunity available to convert colostrum into powder and tablet. So this snap is from my incubation center. You can see Dr. Ramesh sir, who is head of SRS, is standing. We developed the colostrum powder for him. So this powder we developed from Devani bead and from Malnad Gidda. So Malnad Gidda has got high lactoferrin and IgG. So Dr. Ramesh sir, we developed for him, and he happens to be our board member also. This you can make colostrum powder and tablets, and these are a very high value product, and this has to happen at village level. Kulfi, very simple process. Kulfi machine will cost you 65,000 rupees at taluka level or obli level or village level. This rural youths can take up, so they don't have to buy kulfi made from factory. It stays for months together, and these are a small opportunity. This kulfi machine will cost only 65,000 rupees. In 2 lakh rupees, they can establish a small kulfi, chakobar or candy making plant. Epigamia is making big money. For what? So only to make yogurt. So this yogurt, anybody can make it. See, this for 80 ml, they're selling for almost 60 rupees. See, well, that's a value addition. Our rural youth, they can make it very easily. Now, DVS cultures are available. We don't have to worry about culture. DVS cultures are very safe. So a PKMEA product like Greek yogurt, Greek yogurt contains what? It contains yogurt culture plus solids, milk solids will be around 18 plus. So it will be scoopable, everybody will like, and this is the one opportunity available for rural youth. And this Akshay Kalpa, they were startup about 4 years back, and this startup is from my village. Now they are selling 70,000 liters of milk in Bangalore market alone, and they are selling at 110 rupees in the name of organic. So they have developed network. It started with few cows. Now it's a big company handling 70,000, selling 70,000 liters of milk per day at the rate of 110 rupees per liter. And this gulab jamun, anybody can make it. There is no big technology. It's not rocket science. Small startups at village, they can take up this technology. And this seed farm in Hyderabad, he was a software man. See, he makes 44 crore rupees turnover per year. He was a software man. He left the company and he has started this seed farm. And see, he sells for very good price, about 100 rupees plus. And there is a big demand for this seed farm milk in Hyderabad market. And this somebody started similar project in Kolkata. I think it looks like it's a native breed. And those are the opportunities available for Indian farmers to take up and to become Atmanirbhar. Country Delight is one more startup and they're successful. And there is very big demand for donkey milk. In Bangalore, there is a hospital, KC General Hospital. 50 ml of donkey milk is sold for 200 rupees. And milk powder is about 10,000 rupees per kilo. So now there is, I do not know why donkey milk is so expensive. What are the nutraceutical values? Somebody should find out. And there is a growing demand for donkey milk and milk products. Somebody in Kerala has started a big farm and is producing soap and other things. So the nutraceutical values and all, I really do not know. So this business is cropping up, is picking up. And there is big market for donkey milk and its product. And this is my slide. This equipment I developed for developing the low calorie or very high nutritive value of gulab jamuns. So now instead of frying at 140 degree, so in this machine you can fry at 110 degree centigrade. So this was my PhD project at NDRI Karnal, and we got a lot of awards. And I think my equipment is there in NDRI Bangalore. So now coming to the golden opportunities. A dairy plant. So those are the opportunities available at farm level for the rural youths to take up and become self-reliant. At farm level, there are many opportunities. Many, many opportunities. You have to put your hand and make money. So coming to the opportunities at golden level. So this I am not going to touch because I have seen our Upadhyay sir is going to touch completely, speak exhaustively on this harnessing solar energy to connect grid. So I not spend much time, I'll just only one slide close. So today, solar power has come down. Only 20,000 rupees is enough to make to put 1 kilowatt power. So we can, your farm can be independent, our chilling center can be independent, and you can produce mega kilowatt power in our dairy plant because we have a lot of space. So this is solar parabolic steam production. During summer, this with the help of this unit, we can produce steam so that use of fuel source, that is our diesel, coal can be reduced. This is solar hot water. I'm not going to take because time is getting running out. Dr. Upadhyay sir will teach. So now I'll come to this particular topic. Very interesting. Polishing of milk condensate from falling film evaporator and make it a mineral one. So this very interesting project. We are implementing to one of the federation in Karnataka. And we are a consultant for the whole project. It's about a level 15 lakh liter dairy plant with the 30 ton podu plant. Our department is executing as a consulting engineers. So now we see. So if you can polish condensate, milk condensate coming from a 5 effective evaporator, so annually you can make 20 lakh rupees can be generated just by selling water after polishing. So that's the concept. It consists of, and you can see on left hand side, we have reverse osmosis plant. On right hand side, we have activated the charcoal filters. Pass through that and add the minerals. So your water will be as good as distillery water. This in North India, I have installed solar in more than 50-60 milk powder plant. All of you can think, it's not a big project and it's a viable project. And we call it as a condensate polishing. So polishing condensate from falling film evaporator, make it a mineral water, sell for 2 rupees per liter. You can make a lot of money. So that is the one golden opportunity available for the companies who are having milk powder plants starting from 10 ton, 20 ton, 30 up to 6. Today we are talking about 100 tons. Or for everybody, we get a lot of condensate water. Condensate water will come from milk only after piling milk. So we get pure milk condensate that can be used and converted into drinkable water. So that's one golden opportunity available for the processing. So rainwater harvesting known to us from ages. So we are spending huge money for water treatment. We purchase water, we buy water because already we have depleted the gold water. We are buying a lot of water. So if we can harvest rainwater, store it. Harvesting, so storing is easy, very simple job. That water can be used in the process. So very interesting is converting dairy effluents. We all know that for every liter of water, every liter of milk we handle, 1 liter of effluent is produced. And it's a continuous process. So every day we are buying milk, throwing the effluent out. So with this concept, zero liquid discharge, we call it as zero discharge liquid. And you know, pollution control board is very strict. They say, do not pollute. If you are polluting, you drink. So if you are producing, you drink. That's the concept they have introduced. That's called zero liquid discharge. Our industry is producing huge volume of effluent. So we are not supposed to drain the effluent. So for that, zero ZLD concept is coming up. Already other industries have already adopted. Our industry has to adopt. So in this process, what we do, after treatment, after UASV and after passing through sand filter, after passing through activated charcoal, that water we pass through reverse osmosis, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. The permeate is taken to process, reject is we take it to evaporator, we concentrate. And the concentrate is treated, we get small quantity powder. It's not a big volume, it's small quantity powder. And the permeate, we pass through pasteurizer or DSI, we heat up to 95 to 120 degrees centigrade. Now this water is safe for usage. So this is the technology, it will come up, we have to adapt because we are producing huge volume of effluent and we are not supposed to do that. And ZLD is becoming, it's becoming the order of the day. And pollution control board, both state and central, they're implementing stage by stage. And it's going to be reality. All of us should be ready. And we get the water and we don't have to buy the water from outside. And we can avoid depleting the our mother earth. So then if you process properly, so this is the quality of water. From the effluent, from the dairy, this is the dairy plant effluent. And we get that much water. And this water, it's a potable water, can be used in our process. So well, potable water we get biogas and we get sludge. Sludge can be composted, we can make briquette, and there is no need to buy water. Huge saving for the dairy plant, and dairy will become self-reliant. So this is the water we get. So the mission completed, that means we are effectively implemented the ZLD. So E3 recovery system, I'm not going to touch because our Sharmaji is going to speak on E3 recovery system.
Mahesh, please speed up.
Over, sir, 2 slides only. So this I'm going to bypass. And this is one technology all of us should adopt. So this is the, right now we are using static UPS. Static UPS requires a lot of batteries and all. Instead of new technologies come, rotary UPS. If you adopt rotary UPS, your investment on battery, investment on maintenance, everything will take care. So now rotary UPS is the concept out of there today. So diversifying into the value product, very important is, now it's a time to adopt artificial intelligence, IoT, cyber security, and blockchain and data analytics into dairy plant so that we'll become self-reliant. Thank you. I think I took a little more time. Sorry.
It's very fine, Raji.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an informative and motivated lecture as far as dairy startups and the new ideas concerned for dairy engineers to work on. Very informative and very motivative lecture. Thank you so much, sir. Other participants, if anybody is having any query, you can ask now, or the question, the same may be typed in the chat box so that later Dr. Mahesh Kumar can answer the same.
I have one query. Yes. Mahesh, I think it is a very excellent talk. And do we ready for the solar panel? Because solar panel is too costly. Government of
not costly, sir. In my department, I have installed 4 panels. we have installed 20 panels, sir. It has costed only 20,000 rupees per kilowatt.
No, but it is right now, government of India is a subsidy is there.
No, no, I am not talking about subsidies. I am talking about the actual price. So that means if you get a 60% subsidy.
No, 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 sir. All panel which is imported one is coming from under subsidized condition because government already actually procuring on subsidized.
Okay, okay.
So now, how it can be actually sustainable dairy industry into this, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, I think that it's not touch this topic because sir is talking. Upadhyay sir is not touching that. That's why.
Because government of India is already under the bound under the you have international usme. We are actually procuring on the subsidized condition, and okay, what we are supplying it is already, and then on processing also on the installation also we make the subsidized way. Okay. So how would go in, means it is a need that we should develop our own solar system. That's yes, the sir. First and need.
Yes.
So if we make any dairy industry, or we if we go and ask that you please go with this, right now they may be sustainable because of subsidy. Later on they are not going to subsidize. So
we have to develop our own panels. Get
that. That's actually my submission only. Just.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. So thank we will thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Priyanka. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Chitranayak, sir. Thank you for giving me an opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Yeah. We are moving now towards the next invited lecture on Indian dairy industry, emerging trends and impact of COVID-19 by respected Dr. P. Sudhir Babu, sir, Registrar, College of Dairy Science and Technology, Kerala Veterinary and Animal Sciences University, Manuti. Sir, I request you to kindly share your slides now. Thank you, sir.
Good morning.
A very good morning to you, sir.
This is for the first time I'm making a presentation on IDEA platform. And to correct regarding my designation, formerly I was working here as the Dean of Dairy Science College, presently Registrar of the University, the Veterinary and Animal Sciences University. Thank you very much. And the topic that I had to present here today.
Sir, I request.
Is it visible to you now?
Yes, sir, it is coming. But yeah, the slides are visible now, sir. Thank you.
Okay, if you are looking at the recent developments in Indian dairy industry for past one decade, the two major issues that we had faced, one was regarding the apprehension about the regional comprehensive economic partnership agreement, and the second one was about the issues that we already had faced during the COVID pandemic and lockdown. And if you are looking exactly these two issues critically, we can see that these two are somewhat similar. Similar in the sense, the first issue, of course, the RCEP agreement and the aftermath of it. Since we haven't signed, we haven't faced it. But the major concern was regarding the surplus management, the import of low-priced milk or milk products to India and how it will affect the Indian industry was there in discussion. That means primarily we are worried about the surplus management. Secondly, at the time when the COVID pandemic came and the lockdown had created a situation where in which the entire supply chain was disrupted and to some extent the collection also was affected. That means again, there is the question of surplus management and at the same time, the lack of proper collection mechanism from the farmer side also. These two together have created a very panic situation. Panic situation means to two different stages. The other one I told you, since RCEP agreement was not signed by India, and no impact was there for the entire industry, but it was expected earlier. But for the COVID, it had created issues. And while discussing about these kind of issues, generally the first effect will be there on the farming side. You know it very well, the collection primarily from the farmer side, it can be either through the cooperatives or from the corporates or other private entrepreneurs. During the initial COVID lockdown period, the first issue was faced in the sense I can say, if you are considering the situation where in which we have achieved although self-sufficiency and huge quantity of milk production is available and the product, it was not possible for us to collect. And this we have to see on the backdrop of the person sufficiency that we have
bit of disturbance is coming.
I'm not getting you.
The disturbance आ रही है थोड़ी सुनने में शायद फैटी टॉन
disturbance is there.
Voice is not clear.
Voice is not clear.
Yes. Audio is not clear.
Yeah.
Audio. Let me see whether I can go for it. Take our arrangements. Audio is not
clear. Any disturbance behind you, sir, like fan or anything else?
Yes. Presentation on.
It's okay now for hear us.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah, is it audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Fine, sir.
Fine.
But the person, one second, that presentation I had to. Okay. Sorry for the interruption. Is it audible now? It's clear now?
Yeah.
Okay. Such a situation we have faced in a stage where we are sufficiently advanced in milk production, and if you are just looking at the post-independence period, we know it very well that from 1960s to 2018 or 2020, from a milk scarcity to almost 21% of the global output, and at present we are here as a net exporter for the dairy products. One second. Some problem. Okay, and if you have to look at the emerging trends, I think that there is no need for us to describe regarding the trends or the development pattern we already had till up to 1992 period. It was basically a licensed industry, and after the delicensing, the industrial growth here in India was at a very very faster rate. And at present, near about 21% of the world milk production is with us, and our per capita consumption also came up to 407 grams per day. And naturally, various technology factors such as crossbreeding, fodder and food technology, and value addition together had created a market of this kind for Indian industry at present. And of course, if you are looking at the production pattern, there is a gradual growth, and that had created the Indian dairy industry self-reliant and sufficient. And naturally, at the time when the industry is going up, the component of value addition also had gone up, but not significantly. We can say if you are comparing between 14 and 20, maximum 5 or 6% growth only we have attained in that area. And looking at the recent trends, not only here in our country, throughout more than the fluid milk share, we are always aiming at value-added segments, out of which better growth is there for the milk beverages segment and nutraceutical segments. And even though our country is a major producer, our export share remains insignificant. And during RCEP agreement discussions also, it was a primary factor. We know it very well. Even though the production is on the higher side, our collection pattern, our processing methodologies, and lack of traceability, many factors together always made it impossible for us to become a world leader in export, other than a few countries like Middle East or UAE, Egypt, Bangladesh, Bhutan, and similar countries of that kind. Our export share will be generally nominal.
Sudhir Babu, sir.
Yeah.
Please, sir, go to slide show mode, sir. Slide show mode.
Slides?
Slide show mode.
F5. Just press F5.
No,
it will come, sir. It will come, sir.
Okay, is it clear now?
No.
Is it visible now?
No.
No.
Earlier it was visible.
But that was a very small portion of the video. It was not in slide show mode.
Sir, we can expand at our end, you know. We can expand at our end.
It may not be that clear.
No. It is my responsibility, sir.
Okay.
You complete your presentation, sir.
Yeah.
Ah.
One second.
Sir, I am the student.
Is it okay now?
I can't understand.
Yeah, better now.
Now better, yes.
Hmm. Okay, and if you are looking at the growth drivers of the Indian dairy product markets, we can see that generally 12-15% average growth is there if it is compared with the global market of 5-7%. And naturally, and the more emphasis there on the safety and quality and fitness and health eating. The market is growing primarily because there is growth in GDP and disposable income. Increasing urbanization and the population demographic differences are also acting as drive factors. And we know it very well, especially I can say states like Kerala, the rural urban divide is diminishing, and naturally there is a chance to go for more processed milk, processed products. Then nuclear families and double income households also will give rise to the market for higher the ratio of markets for the products. And if you're just classifying the dairy industry trends in 2020, generally these are divided into three different trends: environment friendly nutrition, clean label production, transparency and advanced technology. There is a great focus for the sustainable nutrition to the consumers, as people are concerned about healthy foods and environment friendly sources. Then similarly, clean label products, such as, for example, the natural, no preservatives, no chemicals, low sugar, high protein, these type of concerns are also there, and that also will act as a drive factor there in the markets. Similarly, for the transparency, no to genetically modified foods. And coming to the exact topic of the corona effect, see the impact of COVID-19 on the dairy industry, that we can again classify into three different fields, three different categories. Primarily regarding the farming sector, secondly they're on the processing side, and tertiary they're on the markets. I told you they're on the farming side, the impact was of different type for the for farmers, those who are depending there on the cooperatives. Generally, most of the cooperative dairy plants, they were trying to collect as much as possible. I can say that the entire collection chain was disrupted only for a week or two in most of the places. After suffering a lot of setbacks, they were forced to collect milk, and farmers were paid accordingly. Generally in India, I can say, especially for states like Kerala, it was only for a period of 1 week. But for the private players, most of them had stopped collecting, or even milk holidays were declared. There was a reduction in the collection quantity, and basically the farming sector was affected to some extent. But all these were there only for a short period. We know it very well. If for a dairy plant, dairy industry, the entire quantity of milk that is being collected, if you can't supply it out, especially for a fluid milk plant, by a day or two, naturally the entire collection supply chain will be disrupted. Immediate lockdown, such a type of situation was there for the industry for the first time, and there was the effect for that. That was the effect there on the processing side. But for the product side, marketing side, naturally there was the attempt to go for spray drying to convert it into long shelf life products. And again, there was market demand in many aspects. For example, people were looking for products for getting more resilience, for more resistant towards the diseases. For that large number of products were introduced here in the market during this period by various companies. Some of them can be classified into nutraceuticals or fortified foods. Some of them are merely, for example, Chyawanprash ice cream and all. It has nothing to do with ice cream, but only having the flavor of it. And if you are looking at the COVID-related opportunities there in the industry, naturally there is increase in demand for processed and packaged foods for better food safety and hygiene, and explosion of market or exponential growth of market for functional foods or immunity boosters based on turmeric, ginger, tea extracts, and many products of that kind. And another trend that we can say, tastes may take a backseat, and more importance to automation. And since people, especially those who are working there in the IT industry and all, since it was work from home mode, they all were looking for the ready-to-eat products. Yogurt and probiotics, definitely the market will go up. Similarly, for the high-protein dairy products, such as paneer and cheese, it is on the rise. Naturally, reverse immigration of expats, NRIs, will demand for exotic dairy products in the internal market. Single-serve economic packets also are getting a higher market share. And this is for the first time the industry is facing such a large change in a short period. Huge quantity you are collecting, and suddenly the collection and the supply network is affected. Then we should be prepared to face such type of situations there in the future also. And similarly, the personal and community health element, it's becoming more important. And accordingly, you have to provide the product basket also. And the immunity priority, that type of value addition, multifaceted value addition, also is becoming more important, is more significant. And the business also, for example, app-based business to capitalize e-market and artificial intelligence also is another factor that we have to consider in this aspect. And if you're just looking at the dairy industry after the post-COVID period, now also we are unable to define it as a post-COVID, but to that extent, we know it very well. The growth is there, and near about 3.2% CGR will be there for next 40 years. And the livestock sector of India, now it is facing serious constraints, such as low productivity, since the production is going up, but there is a chronic shortage of feed and fodder, large population of unproductive cattle, absence of effective extension system, costly animal health care. All this has to be, and again, lack of cold chain logistics and unorganized marketing. This all has to be addressed in the long run. The unlike food crops, the agriculture ministry doesn't collect data on fodder. Data availability, not only regarding fodder, even regarding the processing facilities available there in the private sector in the country, comprehensive data is not available, and that all is required at the time when this type of sudden issues are coming up to address with the processing capacity, so that maximum can be processed and converted. That data collection also is another important parameter that we have to consider on the background of this type of pandemics. Then the fluctuation in demand and prices of milk is always creating a major challenge for the farmers. There should be capacity enhancement for the processing and storing of excess milk and milk powder. And moreover, there is a demand from the industry, especially from the cooperative side, to provide the liquidity in the sense, for example, if they have 100 tons of milk powder in stock, it may not be possible for the cooperative society to pay out the farmers. And this will definitely affect the farming as well as the production. To avoid that, a liquidity fund has to be provided by the government, not as a subsidy. Whatever is the stock available in the form of SMP or converted products that is in stock, based on that, a funding should be provided from the government agency, so that short-term funding only, so that farmers can be paid and liquidity can be made available, so that industry can go better. And another factor generally we have to consider for countries like India, where we are always worried about the escalation of prices for commodities like milk, since it is a nutritional component that has to be provided for the public. You can't think about increasing the price in huge. For that, we have to bring down the cost of milk production. How it can be brought down, that can be only by boosting the productivity and to explore the possibility for reducing the processing costs. With the series of measures being taken by the government, as well as growing our role of cooperatives and private sectors in dairy development, India definitely can sustain growth in milk production. And at this stage, we can say that even after facing this many issues during the period of COVID, Indian dairy industry is in a position, it is self-reliant, and we are able to address these issues and go ahead with a smiling face. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for an informative talk on the topic, very recent and very much relatable topic of and the consequences that we are all facing as a dairy industry, connectors on the milk production and productivity side, and also the effect on e-market. The very important topics you have discussed as far as the e-marketing and the need-based products that are coming into the market now, like the haldi doodh that you discovered, fluidity of the the prices and the money in the industry with respect to this COVID-19 scenario. It was really a very informative talk, sir. Thank you so much.
At the same time, I'm extremely sorry.
No, it's okay, sir. The technical faults can be at anyone's end, so that is totally fine with this. And in fact, we are very much grateful to you for such an informative talk. I invite any discussion or any query on the topic.
We can put in the chat box then.
Yeah, okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Once again, thank you for such an informative talk. We are moving now towards our third invited lecture on the topic use of solar energy, a step for Atmanirbhar Dairy. A step for Atmanirbhar Bharat. By Dr. J.P. Upadhyay, Principal and Dean of the College of Dairy Science,
Thank you, Priyanka. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Honorable Officiating Director Dr. J. Singh, President of IDEA, Sri S. Agrawal, sir, Vice President Dr. Sani, sir, Sri Chuk, sir, Convener Dr. Banwal sir and Co-Convener Chitra Nayak ji. I am thankful to all of you for providing me the opportunity to share my views on the use of this particular solar energy to become this Atmanirbhar dairy plant. So I will try to share this screen. Is it visible? So what to do then? This device is allowed.
So yes. Start the slideshow.
Screen is visible, sir. Please start the presentation.
Yes.
Okay. Now this will be visible. Okay. Thank you.
But make slideshow.
Okay. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So, I will be telling something regarding the use of the solar energy, a step for the Atmanirbhar dairy plant. So, as we are knowing that the any dairy plant that requires the energy for the processing, and that energy are in the two forms, either thermal energy or either electrical energy. And we are dependent on this particular, on these fossil fuels. Thermal energy that we are getting by using this fuel generating the steam, and that steam is used as the heating medium for either generation of the hot water or directly as the steam. And for running the equipment, we are depending on the grids supplying agencies that is renewable energy, and from there we are using it. But to have this Atmanirbhar, that because of these government policies and they have enhanced this use of the solar energy, we have seen that many renewable sources that we are going to utilize. And in India, we are having a very good opportunity, the climatic conditions that favors the use of the solar energy. So in this regard, that is the international already that I have told you that energy use, but only to want to highlight that which are the renewable energies that are generally used, that is the sunlight is the main, that the wind energy, then falling water, then sea waves, geothermal heat, or the biomass. And this solar energy, if you can say that is nothing but the radiant energy emitted by the sun, and so that we can consider it as the sustainable energy or clean energy, or it is not any type of the non-existing type of the energy. In that certain terminology, that is the solar constant, which is coming on this earth atmosphere, that is about 1368 watt per meter square. And solar insolation, which is useful, that is on the surface of the earth that is taking place, and that is on an average, it is 342 watt per meter square. That is the solar window during which time period we can maximum harnessing this particular solar energy, that is considered as the 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And it is given that in India we are having the capacity of this solar energy of about 5 to 7 kilowatt hour per meter square per day. And this is also availability about 300 to 330 days in a year. So this energy is sufficient to set up of the 20 megawatt solar power plant per square kilometer main area. That means the solar energy either two ways, and there are the solar thermal systems are there, and the concentrated solar thermal systems are also there, and some concentrated solar powers are also there, which can generate the electricity also. And to generate the electricity, the photovoltaic system is available, and in that case also the concentrated photovoltaic systems are also available in the market. Here only I want to see that what is the share of the renewable energy. So that is 35.9, and that is in the case of this 31st December 2019. In this 35.9, the solar power was 9.6, that was the installed capacity. Within only 15 months time period, you can see that this is another slide that is giving you the renewable energy change to this 36.94%, but in that case solar energy, that is 10.7% that is the installed power capacity, and that is the rise within 15 months time period. 11% rise is there as compared to the other renewable sources, which was there increase only by 3% level. So that is what, because of the government policies and the sustainability of the use of this particular solar energy, as well as the systems or plants available in India, which are the robust and having the long life, and that is why nowadays the trend has changed to use this particular solar energy. And when we are using it in the dairy industry, definitely it will be giving you the better sustainable energy sources. Which are that for the thermal system, there are two types, the non-tracking type of the thermal system and the tracking type. So in case of the tracking type of the solar thermal systems, that are provided with only one direction as well as on the two directions movement of these solar panels, either automatic with respect to the time factor, with respect to the sun movement, or otherwise the manual, also the tracking systems are available. Now in case of the non-tracking type of solar thermal system, that are the flat plate collector system, which is having the temperature range of 40 to 70, commonly employed at the household also, in the dairy industry also, they are utilizing for increasing the temperature of the water. Then most of promising is the evacuator type of the solar thermal systems, which is having the temperature range of 40 to 100 degrees Celsius. In that case, the different versions are available in the market. In that case, the YouTube type of the solar thermal collectors, which is having the temperature of 120 degrees Celsius, the heat pipe type of the ETC, that is 140 degrees centigrade, with the compound, the parabolic concentrated type of the solar thermal collector system, that is 180, and the ETC based solar air heating systems are available, which can raise the temperature of up to 140 degrees Celsius temperature. So this is how the non-tracking type of the thermal systems, different versions you can use are the evacuator type of the collectors. Then solar thermal collectors, the concentrating type of the systems that are available. In that parabolic trough concentrator, the temperature is about this concentrator 300 to 400 degrees centigrade and solar power collector 300 to 1000 degrees Celsius. Now these are the photographs of the evaporator collectors and the concentrated solar thermal systems. First of these, the flat plate type of the collector, which is having the temperature of the 40 to 70 degrees centigrade, and it is a common practice, and we are aware about that. So it is containing the dark flat plate absorber, is made of the thin metal, typically copper, and painted with a selective coating to absorb the solar energy. A transparent cover that allows the solar energy to pass through and protect the absorber. The heat transfer fluid, this may be the antifreeze or water to remove the heat from the absorber to an insulating tank, and the heat insulating backing to prevent the conductive heat loss because of the stagnation temperature of the insulated thermal collector can exceed 100 degrees Celsius. So here the flat plate collector can be used for the temperature range of 40 to 70. So this is one version, and it is the, everybody knows about this. This is the evaporator tube type of the collector system, where the glass tube, outer glass tube is there. Inner glass tube is there, in between where the vacuum is provided, and that is provided with the inner glass tube is coated with the black cover, and inside that the circulation natural convective currents will be forming, and it is connected with the hot water storage tank where the cold water will be moving down because of the inclination, and because of the convective current the hot water will be coming back, and that is how you can get the temperature range on the higher side. And this is the photograph of this thing. Now in this case, the additional thing that if you can provide with the YouTube type of the system, but in case of that, the inside that the cold terminal is there and the hot, and so YouTube is provided, and that is made up of the copper tube inserted into this, and there is circulating liquid or fluid may be there, and that may be costly. You can use this antifreeze or anti-boiling fluids, and that is transmitting the heat to the heater where the aluminum fins are also provided, and thereby the heat transfer area can be increased, and that is increasing the better heat transfer for the in the heater. So by sweeping, utilizing this, you can generate the temperature range of 100 to 150 degrees Celsius. Another version, this is the photograph of that particular YouTube type of the ABC that is shown. The other is provided with the compound, this parabolic concentrator. And here you can see the temperature, you can have higher than this, that 180 degrees centigrade. And on back side, when it is provided with this type of the compound parabolic concentrator, it concentrating to this particular tube. We have a glass tube where the heat transfer is taking place, and you can get the very high temperature. So because of this CPC arrangement, you can have the 2 to 4 times the higher and solar energy capture, and so that is advantageous. And here you can use this CPC of different types, either using the either heat pipe type or YouTube type that you can keep as per the requirements. So these type of the versions are also available, and this is the diagram, that is photograph that shows this particular system. But it is with the heat pipe collector system, that is another version, where you can get the temperature of 140 degrees Celsius, where it is provided with the inner this copper heat pipe, which is enclosed one, and on the top part that it is provided with the header, where the transfer of heat is taking place. Inside that the non-toxic liquid is present, and the this particular the cold vapor, so when it is hot, then it will be going to the top part where it is releasing its latent heat, and thereby transmitting the maximum amount of the heat, and then it is coming back when it will become the liquid. So when it will be coming back again, that because of the heat transfer, because of the radiation of the solar energy, again it will be converted into vapor. So this is how the conversion is taking place, and you can get the higher temperature. This is another dark solar air heater where you can use the same system, electric tube type of the collector system, but it is heating the air, and that air can be utilized for in case of the drying purposes. So that is also the case. Now this electric tube type of the collectors, there are the different versions inside the vacuum tube also. The reflector is provided at the bottom side of the copper tube, and so you can have the two types solar radiation because of the reflection on the back side of this copper tube also. It is supplying the heat energy, and thereby the efficiency is increasing. So that is how the some more the higher efficient models are also available in the market, which can give you this particular thing. Inside the tubes also, copper tube or other tubes also, it is provided with the helical insert to improve this particular heat transfer value. And that is also the another versions that are tried or that are studied for the purpose in case of this electric tube type of the collector. So these are the mainly nowadays the use of the electric tube type of the collector is promising to have the requirement of the dairy industries as per the requirement of the energy in the particular process. Now the concentration technology, what is that? So that is only the solar concentration, whatever the radiation is taken on this surface, that is returning back or concentrating to the one point, which we can consider as the receiver. This may be at the central point or either it may be a central line. So in that case, you are getting this very high quantity is reflected at the very focal point, and thereby you can get the very higher value of this particular temperature to collect. So that is one example is the parabolic trough concentrator, and that is of the Fresnel type made up of the strips, and so that is concentrating its radiation to the central tube as shown in this particular picture. And this central tube is containing this water which is heated to this 200 to 250 degrees centigrade temperature under pressure, and so that can be utilized for the power generation also. So this is another case where the parabolic base concentrator that is used to raise the temperature of this 200 to 250 degrees Celsius. So that is also another example that can be used for the purpose. So here one example that one case study is given that focus sunlight on this smaller receiver for the each device. The heated liquid being drawn is steam engine to generate the electricity. So out of these, the output of this is about 13.8 megawatt, and that cost is $6,000 per peak kilowatt, and overall efficiency is about 25%. So this is all regarding the concentrated parabolic and parabolic type of the systems are also. This tower concentrator is also there where you can have the very high temperature at this 800 to 1000 degrees Celsius, where the highest state, so the minerals are arranged in a groups in a such a manner so that it is reflecting the radiation of the solar energy to the receiver on this top tower, and from there the high energy is transmitting to this water and converted into the steam that is collected into the steam drum, which can run this turbine and generators, and finally you can generate the electricity. So this is how the usefulness of the solar tower concentrator for the generation of the electricity is there. Now for the electricity generation, mainly the promising thing that we are using and the solar rooftop PV panels that are used nowadays on the houses also, that is what the solar photovoltaic technology, and that is converting the solar energy into the electrical energy through the photoelectric effect. Now the PV cells are usually that are made up of the silicon, so common practice to use the silicon as the material, but the other materials are also utilized, and that are the gallium arsenide, the copper indium selenide, cadmium, telluride, etc. So these are also the other material can be used for making of the PV cells. In that case, it is provided with the semiconductor these junctions, and it is docked with the PN, so positive and negative type of the terminals on the layer on these particular silicon wafers. So as light shines on this semiconductor junction, the photons in the light eject with the electrons, and that causes an electric current. The greater the intensity of the light, the greater the flow of the electricity, and that is what is known as the photovoltaic panel, and that converts the 15% of the solar energy as the electricity, and the balance goes rest as the energy. Here, the conversion of this module, PV module, is made out of this particular silicon. Made up of this polysilicon, then it is made of purified form of the silicon ingots, then it is converted into the wafers, and then it is doped, and then we are getting this P and N junction, and it is containing the different bus bars on this line, that is conductors are passing, which is supplying this particular electricity, that is the solar cells, and number of solar cells joined together making the PV modules. And then PV modules that are utilized, and they are arranged in a way, so that is considered as the, these modules are arranged in the one or more PV modules assembled as a pre-wired, pre-installed level units, and then it is connected together as a PV array, is the complete power generating unit consisting of any number of these PV modules and the panels. So this is how you from the cell, you can have the complete setup of the this solar PV plant, which can generate the requirement of the electricity. How they are arranged in the strings and in the arrays, that means strings means in series. So these modules are arranged in series, that means it will increase in the voltage, just like in the electric basic electricity, we learn that in series the voltage, and in parallel the currents will be add up. So this is how the arrangement of these modules in series, and in this parallel we give you the desired voltage and the current of the particular system. So this is how the connection of the solar cells are done. This is the solar cells 1, 2 and 3 in solar, and on the top part the conductors are passing. This is considered as the bus bars, that you can see either one single, two or three bus bars may pass, and that is how the connection it is shown in this particular diagram, that is positive and negative, and in series connection that is shown. So you can understand how they are connected.
Doctor, please hurry up, please speed up.
Yes. So this is how the module structure is shown. And one example that, so this is the series connection of the modules, that is 236 cells in series. And one example will give you the idea regarding how you can have the number of this series and parallel concern one bar. So if you want to have this 4 kilowatt of the power, then the maximum this voltage 125 volt and the current 32 ampere. And if you are having this module having the 35 volt and it is 8.5 ampere, then you can have these the 4 modules in series, that is in string, and in array you can keep the 4 string of these. So 4 into 4, 16 modules together will give you the desired output of the 4 kilowatt. So here it is 4.76 kilowatt is the output you are getting. So this is how you can get the parameters that are shown on the solar cell. So these are the short circuit current, open circuit voltage, then maximum power point, then current and voltage and the efficiency of the system. So that is what one solar panel, this is the photograph of the solar panel on the back side of that. The peak watt power is given, this 315 is the peak watt, voltage is 36 and current is 8.75 ampere. So this is how the array supplier will provide its value, and that is at standard temperature condition, and that condition is 1000 watt per meter square. That is insulation on this particular solar panel at temperature 25 degrees Celsius and at air mass of 1.5. That means 1.5 times the air atmosphere. This is how the solar cell technology, mono crystalline type, polycrystalline and thin film type that are available, and that are in the different efficiencies, and that are made up of the different materials. So here the different materials that are shown, that which are met, and here you can see this multi-junction type giving the maximum efficiency of the operation of these solar cells. Now this concentrated PV, if you are using them with the parabolic mirrors, you can get the maximum amount of high efficiency multi-junction solar cell. Because of this primary mirror and the irradiation of this secondary mirror is there, and the optical hour that is concentrating this solar energy to the particular solar cell, and you can get the maximum output. So this is the how the difference between the this linear and this concentrating the PV cell, that principle is shown. This is the photograph of this concentrated PV. This is also the photograph of this with the tracker mechanism is provided. So this is all the different system we have seen. So depending upon the dairy requirement, you can use. So this is the one power plant. That is what is solar power plant at the 1 megawatt canal top solar power project. And this is the photograph of the this solar power plant present in Ladakh area.
That's
okay.
Please
wind
up.
So I will winding up this only that energy consumption of the dairy industry is there. Different energy your requirement is there. And in that, the water heating, cooling, pasteurizing, steam generation, drying, pumping, lighting, electrical fans, everywhere, wherever possible, feasible, and the costing permits, you can go for using this. So that will be what. So this is the examples in the different dairy plants. So I am not highlighting this because of the time constraints. But these are the some of the cooling mechanism also lithium bromide vapor refrigeration system. And this solar pumping systems can be also used. Solar generators are also, solar lighting systems are also there, solar fencing systems are also available. And in the department also, we have tried certain versions of this in our research work. And so these are the examples of that we have used. And in our plant, in the Dean Science College, this is also present. At last, I can say that this is the government policy to promote the use of solar energy during these coming years. So that means you can go for it. The price of conventional fuels are also rapidly rising with the shortage of it. And recently we have also heard that because of the shortage, there is a chances are down this particular power failure. New innovations in the solar thermal system and solar PV systems are going on, and they are nowadays available with the very high efficiency. Robust plants are available and long lasting. We are giving about 25 years of that working time. And so with this particular and with the minimum maintenance of this, you can have it. So it is reducing the carbon footprint for the process if you are using this. Then hence the use of solar energy in dairy plant using the combination of thermal and PV system will be definitely a step towards the Atmanirbhar dairy plant in the terms of energy use. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a descriptive explanation of solar energy right from the beginning, how it works and when all the plants have been installed. It has been definitely a very descriptive talk. Thank you very much, sir. Any questions on the topic? Queries can be typed in the comment box. Now we move towards the fourth requirement of the year, by engineer Sanjeev Kumar Sharma, who is working as general manager, QA Milk Fed Punjab.
Good morning, Dr.
May I request Sanjeev Sharma, sir, now. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, Dr. Deep, acting director, NDI Karnal, our honorable president, Dr. S.C. Agarwal ji. Our Vice Presidents, Ishkumar Sani ji, Mr. Chug, and Dr. Banwal. Thank you very much for providing me this opportunity for interacting with the fraternity, dairy fraternity, and the students of the NDRI Karnal and the professional engineers who are serving with the dairy. There is different areas. I straightway come to my presentation. I will share my presentation. So the topic of my presentation is quality and energy management through automation in dairies. This is the brief of our organization, the Milk Fed Punjab, with the brand name of Veka. At present, we are the leading.
Slide show mode mein le loge sir.
Yes, pardon.
Slide show mode mein.
Slide show mode mein, yes sir. It is in slide show mode. It is in slide show.
F5 दबा दीजिए.
Alt F5. Sir, F5 ही. Okay. Now it's okay. It is already.
Sir, आपने सिर्फ विंडो शेयर किया हुआ है. पूरा स्क्रीन शेयर कीजिए तो स्लाइड शो आ जाएगा.
Okay.
शेयर स्क्रीन करके विंडो नहीं सर.
I'll do it again.
Yes.
I am sharing entire screen now. Is it visible now?
Yeah, 100% sir. It's very nice. 100%.
So this is brief about Verka, our organization. We produce around 6.7% of the India's total milk. And the milk fed came into existence in 1973. Earlier, erstwhile to Milk Fed Punjab, the Verka brand came from the old organization. PDDC Punjab Dairy Development Corporation, under which first plant was set up in 1959 at Amritsar, and this plant was inaugurated in 1963. So incidentally, this this Amritsar dairy become the second dairy to be get automated. Right now we have three automated dairies, fully automated dairies, two at Mohali and one at Amritsar, and automation of Ludhiana dairy. It's a complete new dairy is under process. So with the we have learning experiences with automation, total automation, we can improve the not only the overall operational efficiency of the dairies, but also provide benefits to the farmers by way of providing better milk rate to the farmers. Wherever we go for automation, automatically the cost of automation was plowed back in the system within 3 to 4 years. In case of Mohali, we found that within 3 years we have to put a new plant. So we have put up a separate fermented dairy costing of capacity 3.5 lakh liters per day. And because earlier project we achieved the plateau by doing the automation and capacity was fully achieved, and we have to put up another dairy exclusively for the fermented products. So that's how I see the advantage of the automation. So this is the we have 5 dairies out of these 9 dairies. We are going to for fully automation in 4 dairies, and other dairies will be taken in other next steps. So this is our vision and mission of the Milkfed Punjab, and I am skipping these vision and mission statements. It is available on our website. So basically, this is the typical we can say the model of the dairy. It starts from the raw milk reception, processing, utilities, which is the main core center of a dairy. You see, dairy, if you divide into the processing cost of a milk, overall total costing of a milk, then the biggest cost center is the utilities. Largest cost center, which with the passage of time we have observed, is the refrigeration. Refrigeration is the biggest cost center. Second cost center is boiler, fuel. And the third cost center is compressed air. So these are the three main cost centers which constitute the main part of the major part of the processing cost. Rest we have to provide as per the market. We have to provide minimum wages to the workers. We have to provide salaries, wages as per the market. We have to sell the milk as per the prevailing trend in the market. So whatever saving, maximum saving, we can achieve with the help of doing automation in processing as well as in utilities. So here it goes. So what main aim it will achieve? It will gain visibility to the manufacturing process through intuitive human machine interface. We can see the operations going on, see the decision being taken at the floor level. It will increase the uptime if we timely do the CAPs, we will timely do the troubleshooting, or if system itself tell us that the machine is need overhauling, or its following part need overhauling, or it needing top up, then definitely the downtime will reduce and uptime will increase, and it will ultimately result into the overall economic efficiency of the system. So our challenges are to improve the processes and reduce the cost. So material, time, people, energy, and how to manage all these things together, answer is automation. So basically, why automation is needed? We have to control many parameters during the processing, and the more the human intervention is there, there are chances of more variation. We cannot able to control the precisely. Over the passage of time, I associated with the dairy industry from 1998 onward, when even we have not seen even drives in the pumpings, in the pumping systems, in the fans, ID fans, everything was manual. And at that time, we step by step start doing the automation of these utilities and seeing the result over the period of time. And apart from this, automation also enhance the safety, enhance the uniformity in the manufacturing process, eliminate the manual reporting, and making tasks which are beyond human capability. These are few advantages of automation in dairy plants. And last but not the least, the quality. The ultimate result which we need is the quality. So It began from the just from the beginning when we pasteurize the milk. So fine tuning of the pasteurization temperature will not only ensure the proper quality parameters, proper shelf life of the finished product, but also it reduces the unnecessary wastage of the energy at pasteurization level itself. See, and automation done in automatic standardization of the milk will ensure that there is minimum variation in fact while making different variant of milk. Effective plant and CIP will ensure that nothing goes waste while doing the CIP. If we put up a simple connective meter and make a loop of it, we can ensure that till that milk solids remain 6% in the system, that milk that will go into the to the rinse milk tank, and remaining is drained later on. So it not only if we control it here itself, it will also reduce our overall load on ETP plant also. So ETP plant working hour will also get reduced. So in the first phase, if we cure the things, it will lead to the overall saving in the system. Further, the accuracy of CIP and authenticity of the CIP, proper CIP, if it is done at proper time, temperature, it will definitely improve the microbial quality of the finished product also. As I say, the recovery is the key. Our dairy professional, particularly the production people, I used to see, हम लोग देखा करते थे कि जो मैनेजर प्रोडक्शन और मैनेजर क्वालिटी कंट्रोल है वो बैठ के रिकवरी की चिंता में लगे रहते हैं. वो देखते हैं कि यार रिकवरी की जो नॉर्म फिक्स करी हुई है फेडरेशन ने वो मीट हो रही है कि नहीं हो रही है. उनका यही इश्यू होता है कि मतलब हम लोग जो डेयरी प्रोफेशनल जो एक्चुअल फील्ड में जाते हैं दे एक्चुअली वरीड फॉर द रिकवरी. सो इन ऑर्डर टू ईज देम फॉर द वरी ऑफ द रिकवरीज वी हैव टू go for automation so that with better automation we can improve the recovery of the fat and SNF. Of course, recovery will not only improve the cost of better recovery will improve the economy of the plant also, but it will also remove the stress of the that key personnels, particularly in production, head production and head quality control, because they are overall responsible for the recovery. This is the practical thing which I observed. I used to see my colleague worrying for the recovery. Every 10 days, yeah, recovery kam ho gayi hai, kuch karna padega, recovery kam ho gayi hai. And you all are better know how they do to improve the recovery. They either make some cut on the incoming milk. So this is the crux. See, and effective maintenance by automation. If we have some feedback system that will tell us that OEM has some data that bearing has to be replaced at that many hours, and if this PLC generate alarm that after 200 hours your bearing need replacement or your device needs service or it's need overhauling, or if there is oil level is low or its viscosity become low, then definitely the major breakdown could have been averted. So by the way of automation we can have better maintenance schedule, implementation of better maintenance schedule given by the OEM. So as I already told you that major cost center of energy is refrigeration plant. See, if we run a refrigeration plant on SCADA based system and other plant is on manual system, there is a hell lot of difference in saving. We have put up automated SCADA plant in our almost all the dairies except one, and we found that cost of the not only even though apparently we found that overall load has increased, connected load has increased, but by use of SCADA, optimum utilization of the compressors, because the stepless control of the capacities of the compressor, it yield a lot of saving. So better management and control due to automation, it's seamless across the utilities as well as the processing side. It increase the efficiency, it reduce the utility consumption, and it lead to the immediate fault detection. So as I told you, if we are, because all the old dairies in almost all the our federation in northern India, they are set up in late 90s after operation during Operation Flood 3. So some of them has already under new DIDA projects. They have taken up new projects or they are doing automation in piecemeal. So we have to decide that which activity should be automated first. So this is the order of preference, which I found that that is must, which is cost effective. It is cost effective as well as this need to be prioritized on the base of this sequence. So this is integration of multiple sections. Areas of energy conservation: processing, milk packaging, butter, ghee, paneer, flavored milk, and utilities. Refrigeration, electrical, air compressor. So now we will move to state to the refrigeration, where we see what steps can be done. So first is chilled water. See, chilled water distribution system has earlier without automation has a lot of issues, because by the time we are able to get manual feedback from the production section that sir temperature nahi aa raha hai, sir flow nahi theek hai. So then people used to switch over the other pumps, and sometimes when processing is already closed, there those pump start running unnecessarily and giving load on the system, and water is being pumped unnecessarily in the system. So number one is no precise control of temperature, no constant chilled water pressure. These were the basic problems which practically dairies without automation system in refrigeration system used to face. Variation in chilled water temperature, no control of flow, more power consumption. Of course, more power consumption is because the pumps are of fixed capacity. They keep on pumping the water, chilled water, to the system unnecessarily. And one person, of course, is needed to monitor who can switch on or who can throttle the valves also. So by putting VFD on all the pumps and integrating it with the return temperature, taking feedback from the return temperature, and whether we have to take that incoming chilled water from the processing to directly to the IBT or through inline chiller, ammonia chiller, inline ammonia chiller, we can take it directly, or we can take it through inline chiller. So VFD can regulate the speed of the pumps and their stoppage time as well as.
Please hurry up, Sanjeev.
I am going through. So second utility which I prioritize is air compressor. Air compressor, now compressed air is the main component for the automation, because we have to provide constant pressure air through in the header to work all the valves and all the controls efficiently as per the feedback in the system. So earlier people used to put DOL starters in the lines, but we have to replace these DOL starters with the VFD and energy management in boiler through automation. This is the typical flow diagram how we can maintain the firing as well as control the firing as well as the flow of steam by effectively monitoring this pressure and ensuring the burning smooth burning of the fuel. This is the few steps we can take in evaporator. We can have PID controller, bypass valve, and we can control the temperature and control the flow of the incoming steam. So with precise control, we can achieve constant TS, which because the end product, end parameter of the powder, it's BD, particularly BD, because BD is the most important parameter for selling the product. Moment the TS vary, the BD of the finished product, bulk density of the finished product got varied, and your powder should be perfect for because nowadays, you know, we are sitting on the heap of powder. The dairy industry, that the powder SMP particularly, it is ailing the dairy industry nowadays. So in order to compete in the market, we should have to provide best quality of powder to the customer, so that, and they want good BD powder. So maintaining the automation in the evaporator and dryer, we can provide and better quality end product. So result, so they can say, we can say that quality has no cost. This, if your powder sell 1 kg powder sell at 10 rupees extra as compared to your competitor, your whole automation cost will covered up in the one season itself. I am skipping this. This is a few example of the drives being used in milk plants. This is the typical savings which we can get from putting up VFDs. This is the various application of VFD. We can use in exhaust fan for milk powder. We can put in high capacity centrifugal pumps, cream separator, of course, and homogenizers. Because you know, putting VFD on homogenizer, because sometimes we used to have a very lesser flow we need, because homogenizer can be in Indian conditions, particularly for Indian market, we put up homogenizer of matching capacity in the line, but we rarely use that homogenizer for fully homogenizing the milk. We use for particularly for products, and for the products like SFM or other variants where that flow is not that much needed, so we have to throttle this capacity and motor run at full capacity. But if we reduce the RPM of the homogenizer motor, there is a lot of saving involved in the homogenizer. So this is a typical table for showing the return. So I sum up that we not only aim for high quality product, but we should also strive for improving the economy of the operation. We also strive for the saving of the energy, reduce our carbon credits, and try to make this planet better for the generation to come, because the energy saved now will have impact on our future generation, because we are 80% we depend on the imports for the energy needs. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for a very practical for throwing light on the practical aspects of this energy saving in dairy industry. Although we hear this energy saving and energy efficiency theoretically on many platforms, but the way you have shown it with the very practical example of your own milk fed Verka Panjam, it was very eye-opening on how much energy we can save, and also on the different aspects of dairy industry, like starting from milk, homogenizer, cream separation, all the unit operations on where, how we can save the energy. It was really an informative talk. Thank you very much, sir. So we have come to the end of the lecture series. We had 4 lectures by the esteemed dairy engineers throughout the dairy industry. So I thank all of them. May I now request Engineer R.K. Chug, sir, Vice President IDEA and ex-Chief General Manager, Haryana Milk Federation, to give the concluding remarks for the webinar, please.
Thank you, Priyanka.
Thank you, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Respected Dr. Dheer Singh Ji, Joint Director Research, Chief Guest of our webinar. Engineer Sumer Agarwal, President IDEA. Dr. Ish Kumar Sani, Vice President IDEA. Dr. P. Barnwal, Convener. Dr. Chitra Nayak, Co-Convener. And my other colleagues and all the participants, and the important participant I am seeing, Badania Saab, Dr. Parekh, and many others, and of course all the speakers. Today's national webinar was on the topic Engineering Self-Reliance in Dairy Industry. The topic was in consensus with PM Narendra Modi's direction to the country of Self-Nirbhar Bharat. First of all, Dr. B. Barnwal welcomed the chief guest and all the participants, and also gave a brief about the NDRI. The dairy engineering in postgraduate was started in 1972, and PhD program was started in 1977 to 1978. Then Engineer S. C. Agarwal started with a happy birthday to Dr. Ish Kumar Sani, who has happened to have today his birthday, and it is a lot of coincidence that all of us were present on this occasion, and even participants are benefited from that. He also gave about a brief of the IDEA, that it was started in 2002 with our founder president, Engineer M.M. Munjal. It was pure his initiative, but unfortunately he could lead us for a short time and left us to his heavenly abode. It was taken over by Dr. S.P. Agarwala, and he also showed his inability after retirement, and then Mr. S.C. Agarwal took the responsibility on his broad shoulders, and till date leading the IDEA with all his efforts, guidance, and we are thankful to him. Dr. Ish Kumar Sani, Vice President IDEA, told that this was the first virtual COVID session, and thanked the director NDRI for accepting the invitation, but could not attend the same, and kind enough of Dr. Dheeraj Singh Ji to take his place. He gave the exposition of all the speakers, what is going to follow it, and the details I will explain in next subsequently. The main idea, that was a very good idea Sani Saab gave, that it is a, let's make it to a series, webinar series. By rotation we can change the topics, but the main theme can be the same. So it's very good idea taken from, I think, film industry, that they are starting this series, and this will be a good endeavor of IDEA if we can get success and continue it in making it a successful series. He also thanked Dr. Dheeraj for flagging off this series. We are lucky that such a great academician played a role in flagging off this, our webinar series. Then our chief guest, Dr. Dheeraj Singh, who is joint director academics, conveyed the message of Dr. M.S. Chauhan for the success of this webinar, and happily agreed to associate with the IDEA for being a chief guest for this webinar. Very valuable advice were given by the Dr. Dheeraj Singh, that name itself, IDEA, is a wonderful name and most popular name. And the other thing which he appreciated was that it is a good combination of academic as well as industry, because our president comes from the industry background and our vice president comes from the academic background. It is a rare combination which a industry should have, and luckily we are having both the benefits, and that is the need of the hour also. Dr. Dheeraj Singh also clarified and cautioned us that simply not importing the equipment does not make us Atmanirbhar. Atmanirbhar have a bigger vision than what we are thinking of it. That's Dr. Dheeraj Singh. Sorry, right. He advised that this society or IDEA should expand its activities, not only limited to dairy engineering, but dairy processing as well as milk production. Milk production is the key to the dairy industry. If there will be no milk production, there will not be any milk processing. Processing and production should go hand to hand. Production should always be supported by the engineering side. He further advised us that we should go into the production side, particularly pesticide contamination, because as far as production side is concerned, the only successful agency is D-Level, which is doing some work on this field. The introduction of artificial intelligence that can be helpful in sensing evaluation of the products, because presently we are dependent on manual sensation and we take help of many peoples, and the uniformity does not come. With advance in technology and artificial insemination, I think sensing can be a big section where engineering can play their role. Lastly, being as a joint director, Dr. Dheer Singh Ji assured us that you give me specific recommendation, one or two, preferably each sections, and it will be my responsibility to implement it. And that is, we are thankful to him for assuring us such a great assurance. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Then I come to the speaker side. Dr. Mahesh Kumar, who is the head of the Dairy Engineering Section at Dairy Science College, Hubble, Bangalore, and is a product of NDRI Karnal only. I think he is doing wonderful job. And he is a combination of both dairy technology as well as dairy engineering. I think whosoever has passed from NDRI after dairy technology and dairy engineering, they are most successful and they have created their name in their field. Main topic he has covered was in cashing of golden opportunities in dairy industry for making Atmanirbhar Bharat. Major area he also covered that we should give more emphasis at village level, and the main product which can make us rich to our farmers, that he emphasized on cow dung and urine. And government is funding for that. 50% funding is available. And moreover, the investment cost of the machinery is very less. He gave example of number of companies, and even told that every day Bangalore has a new startup, and maximum startups in dairy industry are working in Bangalore south side. Rather, the numbers are limited and less in north side. Urine also, he's covered many products, and as well as gave example of many organizations which are into these. On milk side, fresh milk sale can be done by the villages, because the cost of first supplying milk to the plant and then processing and then distributing it, even sometimes back to villages, that has to be overcome. And I think this is the best idea to start fresh milk sale from the procurement side, village level itself. Not only milk, value-added products can be added, A2 milk, ghee, even a good idea of colostrum powder. That is a wonderful idea, that in form of powder or tablets, because otherwise colostrum don't have a life. But wonderful product, can work as well as medicine also, and that can be prepared at the village level. Greek yogurt, gulab jamun mix, gave example of seed dairy farm. Another donkey milk he covered. It was really wonderful to know that 50 ml of milk is being sold at rupees 200 per liter, and the powder 10,000 per kg. I think this is a good option and good opportunity which can be tapped off. Low calorie gulab jamun can be made. At plant level, he emphasized many things in addition to the solar power, polishing of milk condensate. That is also a wonderful idea to make a milk plant economically viable. And it has manifold, you draw minimum water, because water cost you the money for drying from the soil also. And then you have to pay for its processing, CIP also. If you can convert this, all the condensate from the evaporator, so for a 30-ton powder plant, he told that 20 lakhs rupees worth can be generated, even if we sell this at rupees 2 per liter. It is a wonderful if it can be. Another, rainwater harvesting, that is also because the future war will be fought on water. So it is a better time that we harvest our water, and our dependence on other source of waters should be eliminated. Zero liquid discharge seems impossible, but practically he has proved it at many places that it can be achieved. Rotary UPS and new technology, more emphasis on artificial intelligence and black chip ETC. Thank you, Dr. Mahesh. A lot of thanks for giving your inputs. Second speaker was P. Sudhir Babu, who was a dean of the Dairy Science College, but now he is a registrar of the university at Kerala. His topic was emerging trends and impacts of COVID-19. Under emerging trends, he covered that after delicensing, the growth rate has become very fast, and production in which we have become self-reliant. Value addition, of course, still we are increasing at the rate of 5 to 6%. Fruit milk sale is increasing. Processing capacity is increasing. In 2020, the factors for growth, he says that the environmental friendly is giving more emphasis, clean level production and transparency. Corona effect, he said that there are three fields, farmer side, processing side and marketing side. Of course, there was a problem for a short period, but it has been handled very well. I think nowhere the milk procurement was stopped and the process continued. And processing were also under this very tight conditions. I know how this processing done, but in the market never there was shortage of milk, which is essential item and which is seen earlier in such type of problems. And even marketing was excellent, and the surplus milk was very well converted into spray drying plant. And the opportunities this COVID-19 gave us, that there was more demand of packaging, automation was increased, new products like fortified products, nutrition products, they were increased, protein products demand was increased. Largest change in the dairy industry, that during the shortest period that was seen in the COVID-19 only. We should be prepared for such challenges in future. It has given a confidence to us. Community help is another effect. Immunity product or health priority, e-marketing. So our way forward for COVID-19, that we were able to fulfill the demand, livestock constraints, limited processing capacity, limited grazing land, डाटा कलेक्शन डिफिकल्टी, स्टोरेज ऑफ एक्सेस पाउडर, फंडिंग अगेंस्ट इन्वेंट्री, दैट लिक्विडिटी प्रॉब्लम एंड बूस्टिंग प्रोडक्टिविटी बाय रिड्यूसिंग द प्रोसेसिंग कॉस्ट, दीज आर सम ऑफ द इफेक्ट्स एंड द गुड पॉइंट्स एंड चैलेंजेस ही कवर्ड. थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर योर एक्सीलेंट इन डेप्थ स्टडी. कोई गल नहीं, तो कर ही जाना. आवर थर्ड स्पीकर वॉज डॉक्टर जेपी उपाध्याय, हु इज डीन एसएमसी कॉलेज अनंत. His main topic was use of solar energy in making Atmanirbhar. So he compared the renewable energy by versus solar energy, that during 15 months the renewable energy was increased from 35.9% to 36.9%, almost 1%, and solar was increased from 9.6% to 10.7%. That means almost 90% of renewable energy was increased in the form of the solar energy. This is a very good indication as far as solar energy is concerned. He covered different types of solar collectors and technologies of different systems in market, and mostly material used in silicon majorly and many others. And presently efficiency is only 15%, and we have to go a long way. It's various aspects. It starts from the cell, then it becomes modules, then array, and then finally it becomes a panel. We concluded with that our government policy should be more helpful as far as solar energy is concerned. Price of fuel is increasing day by day, so this is more relevant. Carbon footprint will reduce by this, and in dairy industry we can very well go for Atmanirbhar. Thank you very much, Dr. Upadhyay ji. Our fourth speaker, Dr. Sanjeev Sharma, who is from the industry and presently general manager quality, general manager, and he is basically engineer. He has covered the topic of quality and energy management through automation in dairy industry. So he gave first the brief of the Milkfed brand and emphasized that Punjab is a state which is producing 6 to 7% of the total milk production of India. They have 9 dairies and 3 they have automated and rest they are in a process. He further indicated that in 3 to 4 years this cost of automation can be recovered. The main benefits of the automation he covered, that it improves the quality aspects in processing as pasteurization temperature, moisture control in salt and table butter, microbiology of quality of finished products, standardization of fat and SNF, accurate dosing, and effluent CIP system. Overall load of ETP will also reduced by this. Its main benefit, second benefit, was recovery of milk solids due to automation, which is the major hiccup in dairy industry. And if they calculate that this much is our wastage in crores, if you take it in total countries, so it goes almost 1% to 2% of our total turnover of dairy industry, which is almost 9 lakh crores. So you can take out to 2% of that is going waste, and people say it is a recovery. So a lot of scope in recovery of milk solids. And then effective maintenance of automation helps in effective maintenance in all the sections. Energy conservation by automation, to emphasize that in dairy, maximum energy is consumed in utilities, and in utility also major contributors refrigeration, boiler and air compressor, and by automation you can reduce to great extent. And the overall better management of man, material and energy, that can be done by automation. And he emphasized that every dairy in India should go for automation. It is only a hiccup, but if you start it, you realize the benefits of it, and it is the real need of the hour. Thank you very much, Sanjeev ji. It was a great practical aspect from you. I once again thank you, all my IDEA team, chief guest, speakers, and all the participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving the concluding remarks and thanking all the speakers. May I now request Dr. Chitranayak Sinha, co-convener and general secretary, and also currently working as senior scientist in Dairy Engineering Division, ICAR NDRI Karnal, to please give the vote of thanks. So, please.
Thank you, Priyanka. Hello. First of all, I would like to thank our respected director.
Sir, you are muted.
My voice is not coming.
I am listening. No issue.
Voice is coming, Dr. Sir. Voice is coming.
Yes, it's coming.
It is okay.
Okay.
Many thanks. Huh?
So first, I would like to thank our honorable director, sir, Dr. Manmohan Singh, sir, who has permitted us and approved our idea of conducting this webinar, and his encouraging message to make it a success. So thanks to our director, sir, and then our director in charge, sir, our Dheer Singh, sir, for his very nice and detailed input, sir, regarding this conducting this webinar. And many thanks to Dheer Singh, sir, for accepting to preside over the webinar, and so nicely, sir, has explained how to what to cover in this webinar, sir. And many thanks to Dheer Singh, sir, and he has given full time. He is present with us, so many thanks to you, sir. And then I would like to thank our HOD, Dr. T. Barnwal ji. He has always supported and always he has encouraged to go ahead with the work we were going, and he always guided the way we can conduct this webinar. So thanks to Dr. P. Barnwal ji. And then our three pillars of idea, I can say, Dr. I. K. Sahni sir, Agarwal sir, and Chug sir, they always supported and always guided by which we can conduct the webinar, and what to how the time to time he came and helped in conducting this webinar. So our seniors are really I am thankful to them from my bottom of heart. Then I would like to thank our very senior colleagues like Dr. Badania, Dr. Parekh, Khojare ji, Dr. Vasnik ji, Kohli sir, Ramesh Babu sir, and so many senior people I am seeing here. So joining us, it's very nice to see you all, sir. Many thanks and regards to all seniors. After so long, we are able to meet, sir. Then I would like to thank our all the people who have worked directly or indirectly in arranging this webinar, like arrangement of seminar room and arrangement of line connections, and our technical officers, they have helped in arrangement of this webinar. So I am thankful to them. And then I would like to thank all the participants, senior colleague and students. They have I was seeing that throughout the webinar attendance was around 90. So they have thoroughly attended the webinar. So thanks to you all. And in the last, I would like to thank some names I may not be remembering. So I would like to thank all of you who have directly or indirectly.
Thank worthy speakers also.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And all the speakers who have accepted immediately. Whenever we have sent the program to Mahesh sir, Sanjeev sir, Ramesh Babu sir, and Sudhir Babuji and Upadhyay sir, they have readily accepted our invitation of speaking to the webinar, and so nicely they have covered the topics they have chosen. So, and I hope whatever topics they have covered in very informative lectures, it would be beneficial to all the listeners and all the people who have attended. And I would like to thank all the participants. And in the last, I would like to give over to Barnwal ji and Sahni sir to announce closure of this. And I would like to thank Priyanka. She has very nicely managed the whole process. Thank you. So over to Sahni sir and Barnwal sir, head to announce if closure. Anything. Thanks to all, sir. Many thanks to all, sir. Thank you.
Of course, we are very grateful to our speakers. When I was discussing with Dr. Sahni about who will be speaker, and then we decided. Then one day, just in evening, I talked to all four, and within 2 minutes, they were agreed. And just in the morning, we got the titles of the topic also. So we are very thankful to all of them. And we have come at the end of this. So what the take-home message and other things will be there, that will be said by our Vice President, Dr. Sahni ji. So I invite Dr. Sahni ji for this.
I thank all the participants, all the speakers, all the organizers, and all the stalwarts of the Dairy Engineering, Indian Dairy Engineers Association, NDRI Karnal, and all other organizations who have made this webinar a very, very successful event. So as we have already proposed that we'll continue this event in the form of series, and next time we'll take this role to some other organization. They will host it, speakers with different topics, but the main topic should be the self-reliance in dairy industry. So I hope that we'll continue this. With this, why I thank one again. And Dr. Madania has suggested on the web chat that we should have a review meeting of this webinar. We'll hold this review meeting very shortly. Once again, thank you all for participating and joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
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 Bye.